Hi, everyone. My name is Natasha. So I was at WWDC when Swift came out. I was like one of the lucky people, and it was really exciting. And at the time, I had zero functional programming experience. So I'm an iOS developer. I did Ruby on Rails before. And you know, so I'm used to the object-oriented world. But then when Swift came out, everyone just started saying, oh, it's kind of like Haskell. You know, you should look into functional programming. And I've heard the term, obviously, but I didn't really know what it was. So in the past few months, I've been kind of following different blog posts, I did the edX functional programming 101 course, just trying to read up on it. And as I've been learning it, I think there's like, it can get very complicated. So I've been trying to focus on parts that like make sense to me and thinking kind of, you know, someone who's coming from object-oriented land, kind of thinking, you know, what patterns can I apply and what are the high-level concepts that I can apply in my code? And, you know, one of the cool things about Swift is that it is a new language. So as a community, we don't have kind of standards yet. It's like less than 200 days, you know, that it's been out. So, you know, I like to learn functional programming to understand kind of like where's that balance, what should be the best practices, you know, where's that line? So that's just my introduction. And for those of you who don't know what functional programming is, which I didn't, so I had to look it up. I was like, it's something about functions, but you know, other languages have functions. So the definition from Wikipedia is functional programming is a programming paradigm that treats computation as the evaluation of mathematical functions and avoids changing state and mutable data. So as you can see, there's no mention of like monads or functors. and the concept is pretty straightforward when you look at it at that high level. And I think the only hard part is kind of like, what's a mathematical function? And this is probably not the most elegant quote, but from the edX Functional Programming 101 course, you know, the professor mentioned a mathematical function is a function that when you give it the same argument, it will give you, you know, the same result. So in a functional language, you know, a function basically has an input and an output, and it's very self-contained and it doesn't have side effects. There's no global variables, right? So that's why it's like considered like a pure language, because everything is very self-contained and like happy world. So the only way a function can have an effect on the world is if something uses its return value, but on its own it's very self-contained. It gets an input, it does something, it gives you an output. So again, like as I'm going to talk and as people are going to talk today, you know, kind of keep in mind these three points from, you know, the Wikipedia definition. And when things get complicated, you know, it's okay. Like it's, you know, you kind of start learning the basics and high level concepts, and then you end up understanding more and more. And, you know, I can read functional books and understand a lot more than when I started. So. Hopefully this will be a good introduction. So the three things, you know, you're thinking of mathematical functions that have an input, output, you know, that are self-contained. You're avoiding changing state, and you're avoiding mutable data. So let's do this. as a beginner, I want to focus on things that I've been reading that, you know, I'm basically starting to apply a little bit in my Swift code, and I'm starting to think a lot about. So these are just basically like interesting. I think like when you come from object-oriented programming, with that experience, you have certain like ingrained, almost like muscle memory ways of doing it, right? You see a problem, you know the answer because you've done it like 100 times before. And one of the challenging things about functional programming is that you have to like rewire your brain. Like you can't just, when you have an obvious problem or like an obvious solution to a problem that you've done, you know, 100 times, you have to kind of stop and be like, oh, can I use, you know, like a struct or enum, which is like kind of a more powerful in Swift, to solve this problem in a better way, or should I use generics? So I think in that way, like Swift is harder than Objective-C. I think Objective-C has that learning curve of, you know, there's those square brackets and pointers, and that part is hard. But once you get past that, you know, you have classes, you have functions, and it's all kind of the same. But in Swift, there's like a lot more choices, and you have to like think, you know, you have to stop your muscle memory, and you have to be like, you know, is this the best way of doing it? How do I do it better? You know, and then if there is a functional way of doing it, you know, is that the way you actually want to do it? Is that the best way, you know, with Swift? So, you know, these are just some things that I was kind of like almost rewired my brain and like made me think differently. So hopefully that'll help you. So the first concept is basically, again, no side effects. And I think this is almost like the core concept from functional programming. So when Swift first came out, and there were these like reduce and map and filter functions, which I was like, that looks cool. And then, you know, my coworker Louis on Twitter, he showed me this quick demo in the playground that made a lot more sense to me. So let's say you have an array of like numbers 1 through 10, and then you're just trying to add the numbers, and it's like late at night, so you write it like this. And, you know, at first look, this is, you know, legitimate. You're basically going through the array, adding them to a total. So now you have the correct total. But then, you know, somewhere later on in your program, you might want to call this function again. And this has side effects, right? Your total global variable is now changing. It's not acting like you probably expected to act. So this is not, you know, this is not functional way. And if you, I've been doing like a lot more unit testing, and if you had to unit test this code, you know, you'd probably have to do some kind of dependency injection to like change the array out, to reset the total. It's not fun to unit test. So this is the more kind of functional way of doing it in Swift. And notice that, you know, there's basically the main thing is the add number function is going to take an array. It's not going to use the array in the global scope because that's the input, right? And, you know, we want to make sure that when you have the same input, you have the same output, and there's a chance that our global array might change. So now it's like a lot more self-contained. We're also using the reduce, which is like the new, more functional way of doing things in Swift. Notice that reduce, you know, it always has a starting point of 0. And then, yeah, reduce is a higher order function, which is like a functional concept, but which like all it means kind of sounds scary, but it just means that it's a function that takes in a function, or a function that returns a function is also higher order. So in this case, reduce takes a function that, you know, goes through basically for each item in the array, it's going to add up the number, and you can do a nice shorthand, which is like 0, plus. So again, like if you had to test this, it's very self-contained. And every single time you run this function, it's going to have the exact same impact, right? As long as you're using the same array. If you use a different array, it's going to be a different number. But the different array, every time you use it, it's always going to be the same. And it's never going to impact any global variables. And it's easy to test because the test, you know, it's always going to return the same thing. So how do you use this in your code? Since it's the holidays, I'm gonna, you know, think of making some kind of gift tracking app. So we have, you know, a gift object, and it has maybe like a recipient, what's the item, what's the budget, what's the status, where, you know, what do I have to do with this gift? So it's pretty standard gift object. But then I want to make a to-do list in my app. And, you know, I might, you know, want to do it this way, right? Basically, based on the status, I'm going to do a different to-do item. Because, right, like the next, when you purchase it, next step is wrap it. When you wrapped it, the to-do item is mail it. So again, this looks, at first glance, like that's how you might do it, right? But again, like when you're thinking of the side effects and dependencies, you can see that this to-do function is, you know, it's based on the status, which is a property on the gift. So you're relying on an external, you know, external of the function something that's external to the function. So how do we do this kind of like in a more functional way? It's very simple, just by adding, just passing in the status instead of using the status that's like in the, that's the property, you kind of made this a lot more contained. And the benefit of this is if you're doing a to-do app and you just purchased your gift, you might want to wrap it and mail it, right? You have two tasks to do, not just one. So you have, by passing in the status, you have a lot more flexibility to do that type of stuff. And again, for testing, it makes it a lot more self-contained. And you can see this if you do actually write tests for it. You could see that every single test, I have to create a new gift. And the gift object, you know, it can be exactly the same except for this, except for the status. So if a new person comes to this code and they're like, I'm just going to refactor it, they might, you know, want to be like, we're repeating, we're making all this gift. Why are we doing this? It's not very clear. Maybe like from the tests, and you can see that there's this dependency. In the other use case, you know, when you have this to-do function and you're passing in the status, it doesn't really matter, right? Like what the gift is. You don't even have to do a setup method. Like it doesn't matter. You're passing in the status, so it's again a lot more self-contained. And in fact, it's self-contained. It could be like a class function, and you don't even have to create a gift object. So this is just, you know, one small way you can move forward functionally without like going, you know, doing generics or like functors or monads. A pretty simple way to think about like, is your function self-contained, testable? So pretty cool concept. Next thing, I think coming from Objective-C, for those of you who are iOS developers, I think like using value types is pretty new concept. In Objective-C, you're using reference pointers to objects, and you're always modifying, you know, the original object. But as you remember from the Wikipedia definition, part of functional programming is to keep, keep immutability, or like don't mutate, avoid mutating data. So value types is a way to do it because they're passed. You're basically passed as a copy, so you're changing, you're manipulating the copies versus the original. And this is from the functional Swift book that really stood out to me. But all the types in Swift are value types, including arrays, dictionaries, numbers, booleans, tuples, enums. You know, classes are the exception rather than the rule. So you can see that, you know, the language creators had this, you know, at the core, as the core concept. So I think like a challenge with Swift, especially if you are coming from, you know, Objective-C, is to know, like, when do I use enums? What's a good way to use structs? So I'm just going to share an example that, like, really stood out to me. And hopefully I'll get a lot better at this. And there's, like, lots of cool examples. But the example was from Alexander Salazar. I don't know how to pronounce his name. But he had a great post about doing error handling. So if you're coming from Objective-C, this is basically one of those muscle memory things, right? It's, you know, Apple has kind of very similar APIs where you pass in a pointer to an error. If you're creating your own arithmetic class and you want this divide function, you have to keep track of the case where you divide by zero and there's an error. And you can see that this code, like if you think about it, it's not that great because you just want to divide two numbers, but now you have to pass in this third thing, which is the error. And when you get back the result, you can't just use the result. You know, you have to check, is there an error? Otherwise, do something else. You might forget to do that. You know, it's not forced to check that, and now your code might crash. So this is just, you know, a lot of self-checks that you have to do while designing your program. But it works in Objective-C. But how would you do this with, you know, enums? So he came up, if you really think about it, you're getting back a result. The result might be, you know, success or failure. You can't have both. So this is kind of like an either or type. So you have this case success and a failure. So now when you get your result, you just call divide And now you don't have to worry about this like weird error state. You're getting the result object. And when you're using the enums, right, you can switch on the result and it's gonna force you to handle success and failure. You don't have to remember these like if statements. So he has like a lot more on it, including using generics. So you can kind of go to his website, read a lot more on this. But you know, I think the core concept of just like rethinking the muscle memory and thinking, you know, oh, can I do this in a different way that's kind of more, maybe like more readable. So this is just things to keep in mind. Next thing I've been, I guess, maybe like struggling with is currying. I understand maybe like the concept of currying, but I've been like learning how to use it. And currying is basically applying functions like kind of like for one variable at a time. And I learned that in Haskell, you can only pass one parameter to like any function. You can't have multiple parameters. So the way they do that is you basically pass in a parameter and then it returns a function where you pass in the second parameter, returns a function, you pass in a third one. So it's a very interesting way of thinking. So here's an example. You can basically have a simple add function where you like take x and y and add it. So this is just the typical way of doing it. But you know, if you were to do it with currying, you're now, again, like you're passing in one thing at a time. You're passing in the x, which is an int. And that returns a function that takes an integer and then returns an integer. So because the second integer is not named, you kind of have to do the kind of closure syntax and return that x plus y. And because it's a partial addition, right, you can say like add, pass in 2, and now you have, you know, you can like kind of add different other things to your 2. So instead of kind of doing it right away, you can take this add 2 and you can even have a whole array that each number you're adding to. So you can kind of start maybe seeing some of the usefulness of this. You can kind of have one number for this function and you can have multiple values where it goes through and does the same thing. And you know, this could be written in a nicer way. Like if, especially like I personally don't like that the second element doesn't have, you know, a name. So you can just kind of do parentheses y int and it's the same. So now when you call this function, the second parameter is gonna have a y versus like a 2 and a 3. So it's a little bit more readable. But the best, I think, like example of this that I've seen so far, was for, I think, like Andrew Wagner. So he had an example where, you know, he was creating just like kind of like a login class to log in your like different warnings or errors. So it's pretty kind of like self-explanatory. You have, you know, debug mode, warn mode, error mode, like if you don't want any logging, so you have different levels, because like if you're in production, you probably don't want to be in debug mode, you want to be in probably like error mode or something like that based on different environments. And just has a description of, you know, what does each one do. So it's pretty simple. The cool thing is, so, you know, you obviously for logging object, you want to have a log function. You want to log the error or warning. So this log function is curried, so you can see that it's parentheses around each one. So it takes one argument at a time. It takes the level that you're in, whether you're warning, debug, mode. It takes whatever, like, the name of it, the name of your function, probably, and then the message. And then based on the level that you have set, kind of, like, globally of which level debug mode you're in, it's going to, you know, print something or not print something. So pretty straightforward. And when you do the curried version and you call these, it's kind of funky because you're like, okay, like how is this better than just having comma separated arguments? And it kind of, you know, looks weird, may not be as readable. But the real magic comes from this. So now you can kind of partially apply, you know, the log, the level, And you can assign a variable to each function. So the debug function is now a lot more readable. You're passing in a name and a message to, and you know when you're writing your code, you're doing it to debug, warn, error. So this is an example. I have my function, I have some variable and I want to debug it. I'm now doing something to X, and now you can see that my code is a lot cleaner. I'm just saying, debug mode versus this is the level dot debug. It's not as readable. So this is kind of starting to look a lot better. And of course, if you need to maybe log two variables in that function, you can again kind of partially apply the function and get the function that takes in the name, and now you're just passing in the messages each time. So hopefully you can start seeing kind of the benefits of currying and kind of separating out your code from having kind of three things that you have to pass in to separating it out even more to say, I'm okay with having partial functions because I'm gonna reuse them, right? They're a lot more reusable in your code. And the final thing that I've been really loving in Swift, and I know in other languages, Objective-C, there's type aliasing, but one of the things I've noticed in functional programming is that using type aliasing is a lot more common, and it makes code a lot more readable. So this is something that I want to adopt for my code. And this is an example from the functional Swift snippets, if you haven't looked at them, but this is probably my favorite one, because it's so simple. But let's say you have an account, and I work at a bank, so this is a cool example. but I have a function that, maybe asks a data source for, or a backend, right, for how many credits are in this person's account. So it's pretty simple, and this is how you do it. You return an int. And great, that works. But then later on in your code, you have this int type that's running around. You might not know. You're like, is this money? What is this? So one thing, that's very, very easy to do is you can type alias the int. And this is something that wouldn't have really occurred to me because it seems kind of crazy to just type alias. I've type alias in Objective-C, a function or a closure type. It goes from this type to this. But this is something very simple. You're just taking an int and you're saying this is a credit. But it makes a lot of difference. Look at this code. It's a lot more readable. And throughout your code, when you go down, when you ask, when you're working and looking at what type is something, instead of saying, hey, this is an int, and you have to remember, what is this int? You can see that, hey, it's a credit, right? And that is not only readable, but as a programmer, that helps you think, you're now in a different mindset of thinking, this is an int, I can add stuff to it, to, oh, this is a credit, right? This is money, this is how do I treat it? And there's a great article, and also a link for it, but this is just the beginning of types, right? Of using types and making your code readable, but there's a great quote, I think his name is Voter. He wrote, one important lesson I learned is that designing the right types of your for your problem is a great way to help the compiler debug your program. So just doing that part credits is a start. It's not going to actually, in that case, the compiler won't help you, but it will help you if you think of it in this next way. So instead of just type aliasing your int to credits, you can actually wrap it in a struct. So now when you try to, and you return, you add the struct, you return the struct. But now when you actually create the credit, if this is something that shouldn't be mutated, where you don't want it to add one because it's something from the back end and you don't want it, you don't want it to be changed, by wrapping this in a struct, you now cannot add one. So really think about what type something should be not only makes your code readable, but at this point, you know, if you try to add one, like the compiler will, again, like fail for you. So this is like a great way of putting like bumpers in your code and putting intent and showing that, you know, this is what I mean, and making the compiler do the debugging for you, because someone else coming to your code, they're not gonna be able to do that by accident. So again, like, can read the snippet, and there's a really great article with the and Swiftcast TV with the design types. So just some of the resources I've been using, and it's just the functional Swift book is great. You can read it a couple times. the edX Functional Programming 101X class is good. Like, I watched all the lectures, and I think understanding like Haskell and just like the intro part to it, like, and then you go back to Swift, you can understand what, you know, like why certain decisions are made. The functional snippets are great to kind of look through and like start kind of thinking more functionally. And then there's a really great Swift London talk on, you know, this introduction to Haskell walks you through everything. And I have a newsletter where I'm like kind of keeping track of all this like Swift related stuff, and you know, I'm gonna be doing a lot more kind of like thinking about functional programming, so you can follow that. Yeah, so I guess for me, there's like different ways to do functional programming. And as you read like more and more resources, some of them might be kind of like confusing or whatever. So you know, I like to think of it as in terms of readability, right? Like if someone comes on my team, and they look at my code, are they going to be confused? Will they be able to debug this problem? So as you kind of learn functional, and I think you know, part of Swift is also, you know, finding that balance of like how much functional they use, how much you know, object-oriented, where's the line for my team? But like the first step to that is understanding functional programming. So you know, I like to learn. Like, I like to learn the extreme parts, and that's what I'm going to be working on. Because if you don't know the like harder parts, then you don't know where that line is. So hopefully you'll kind of start learning it a little bit, because I think just learning the little that I know has helped me a lot with Swift and understanding like why certain APIs, like the range, you know, range APIs, like designed that way, because it might be confusing at first. So you start kind of thinking in a different way and making those decisions smartly, instead of kind of relying on your muscle memory and not doing, you know, the best practices. Yeah, so does anyone have any questions?
Have you found any use for assertions?
The question is, have I found any use for assertion? So there was like an interesting article, I think like on humanfriendly.com, where you can, if you're using like the nil coalescing operator, so you know, if you wanna, sometimes like in Swift, if you don't wanna force unwrap something, you have to do like question mark, and then like create an empty object to return. But in some cases, you don't want it to ever be empty, but it, you know, it just has to be an optional. So he was using assert for, like, asserting in, you know, not in debug or development environment that it wasn't nil, because it shouldn't ever be nil, but it's like the way code is structured, you have to kind of do it as an optional. Yeah. Any other questions? Okay.